Probably one of only two copies in existence at the moment, the book that we are launching tonight, Li Buffoni, which is referred to as a ridiculous comedy, Una Commedia Ridicola, in the outstanding edition and translation of two students from NYU, students once, now professionals with their own careers, of whom we are extremely proud, Sarah Diaz and Jessica Geffels. I will introduce them more in more detail in a second, but I just want to say how happy I am that they have been able to join us from Alabama and from Connecticut to be here this evening with my wonderful colleague Suzanne Kuzik in the Department of Music, who will say a few words, and two actors from the Tisch School, Richard and Ali, who will be bringing to you, again, the first North American performance of several scenes from the Buffoni. So you're all in for a real treat. And I should mention that this is the third continent, really, on which the Buffoni has been performed, because it's set in Africa. It was performed in Italy in the 1600s, and now we have it in North America. So we're bringing it across the ocean to the United States. So to somewhat more precise intros, and then I'm going to let everyone else take over, and I will sit down. So Sarah Diaz, one of our two editors and co-translators, earned her PhD from this department with a dissertation on marriage in Dante's Divine Comedy, and she is now assistant professor of the practice of Italian and Italian language coordinator at Fairfield University in the Department of Modern Languages and Literatures. Sarah has published on a number of Italian authors, and she has a forthcoming chapter on Boccaccio's anti-matrimonial invectives in a volume called Reconsidering Boccaccio, Medieval Contexts and Global Intertexts, edited by Olivia Holmes and Dana Stewart. And Sarah is currently working on not one other Costa project, but two at the moment. She's working on the critical edition and translation of Margherita Costa's Love Letters for the Other Voice series, the same series in which the Buffoni has just appeared. And she's also working on a digitized archive of Costa's many, many works. So we're glad that Margherita Costa, who you'll hear much more about, is beginning to get the attention she deserves again on this side of the ocean. Jessica Geffels, our other co-editor and translator, also received her PhD here at NYU in Italian Studies, and she is currently assistant professor of Italian at the University of Alabama. She has held postdocs from NYU, the University of Pennsylvania, Villa Itati, and most recently the Folger Shakespeare Library in Washington, D.C. And Jessica, too, is not surprisingly finding much more to say about Costa. Even though Li Buffoni is done, she's currently writing a book tentatively titled Margherita Costa, Diva of the Baroque Court. Jessica has two other Costa publications besides the new book. One is an article called The Bizarre Muse, The Literary Persona of Margherita Costa, which came out in the journal Early Modern Women. And she's also written an article called The Patronage Politics of Equestrian Ballet, Allegory, Allusion, and Satire in the Courts of 17th Century Italy and France. And I single this article out because it just won the very prestigious William Nelson Prize from the Renaissance Society of America for the best article published in their journal, Renaissance Quarterly, in 2017. Jessica has also written on a number of other Italian authors, including Pietro Aretino, Luigi Guicciardini, and Paolo Jovio. And luckily for me, she has been serving as managing editor of the journal I edit for Itati Studies in the Italian Renaissance. And she was up till the wee hours of this morning just getting the whites ready to send back to the press. So thank you, Jessica, for all of the hard work you've done for the last 5 years. We're also joined by Suzanne Kuzik, who is professor of music here at NYU, and who is undoubtedly one of the leading musicologists who is working today, having opened the field to a number of important new issues over the last 20 years, especially in the area of gender and sexuality, and more recently in the area of sound studies. Suzanne's fabulous book, Francesca Caccini at the Medici Court, Music and the Circulation of Power, which came out in 2009, received the 2010 Book Prize from the Society for the Study of Early Modern Women. And Suzanne is currently at work on a manuscript entitled Men Hearing Women in Medici in Florence, which examines, among other things, the sounds of Florentine convents and churches. Suzanne has been an outstanding citizen to her field. She has been editor since 2003 of the journal Women in Music, a journal of gender and culture, which is the first journal and still the only English language journal that is dedicated to the relationship of gender and sexuality to musical culture. More recently, Suzanne has been working on issues of sound and gender coercion in the detention and interrogation of prisoners that have been held during our centuries ongoing and seemingly unending war on terror. Suzanne has held a number of grants, including a fellowship at Veritate, and she is also currently being a very helpful member of the board of the journal Itati Studies in the Italian Renaissance. So thanks so much again to Suzanne for being here. And last but not least, let me introduce our two actors who have been very kind to join us tonight from Tisch, Richard Dent, in the wonderful, buffoon shirt, right? Already
visible. Oh, yeah.
is an actor, teacher, and visual artist. He's currently the movement and mask instructor at HB Studio and is a graduate of Juilliard Drama. And next to him is Ali Soheli, who is also a graduate of the Juilliard Drama Division. And his byline is that he recently died on the season finale of Law and Order, and he will be dying again on the CBS series Instinct. But we will hope he will come to life soon in yet another series. And he will certainly be coming to life tonight in a little bit from several scenes from Li Buffoni. So with that, I want to thank our audience for being here and turn things over to Professor Kuznick. Suzanne.
Well, thank you, Jane, for that wholesome introduction to all of us. And thank you, too, for producing this wonderful book. Although I have not actually had a chance to read the play, I've had a chance to read the introduction. And that alone is worth the price of the book, so you should buy it. It's worth the price of the book because it so thoroughly synthesizes the literature in any number of academic disciplines to contextualize this particular comedy, probably better than anything I can say to you this afternoon. What I can say is a little bit about the prehistory to the performance world of this comedy. We think it was performed somewhere in Medician spaces shortly after it was written in 1641, a time that was still kind of a transition time to the long reign of Grand Duke Ferdinand II. No, I'm sorry. Yes, Grand Duke Ferdinand II, who significantly had been largely raised by his mother, his grandmother, his perpetually dying father. Truly, it took him 10 years to die, which was a source of great anxiety to his mother and his grandmother. But he was raised in a world that really privileged female culture over male culture, and that had some interesting impacts on his choices as a patron of the arts, and also the choices of his brothers, who were also involved in supporting the career of Margherita Costa and her sister, Francesca. The grandmother was Grand Duchess Christine de Lorraine, a French princess who had married Ferdinand I in 1589. Their marriage partly celebrated by a spectacular set of intermedi that people in my profession tend to think was the immediate ancestor of Ahura. Certainly the pair of them were among the patrons of the first court entertainments to be describable as opera, although they were not yet described as opera in any language. Those entertainments, largely based on stories from classical mythology, draw as interpreted by Ovid, were, however, the official public culture of the court. They were the official public culture of the men of the court, the sort of patriarchal establishment of the Medici lineage. But Christine, the mother of eight children, Delena, her daughter-in-law, Cosimo II's wife, and Ferdinand II's mother, each cultivated their own courts in palaces that were devoted to female and domestic life. And the children lived with the mothers, with the fathers pretty much coming out to create more children. In the case of Christine, most of the visits were obviously conjugal visits. And she didn't spend very much time as a young wife in the city of Florence. She spent most of the time with the children, surrounded by female servants and male servants. But among the female servants were women comedians, including women dwarfs. And that's an important trope that shows up in the Why. And some amazing women singers. The book that I wrote on Francesca Caccini really argues that Caccini, who wrote no fewer than 14 entertainments for the women's court, only one of which is commonly called an opera. That's a misnomer, it's not an opera, but it was a publicly performed instrument of state in 1625. And it's believed to be the first opera composed by a woman, hence its notoriety. Caccini had been hired by Christine when she was 20 years old for her skill at writing the music for a particular kind of entertainment that was performed at carnival, at which she was not present. She was never present because the roles, including the role of the slave girl discovered to be a queen, the foreign slave girl discovered to be a queen, which I interpret as a kind of reference to Christine at that moment acceding to a de facto regency because Ferdinand I was incapacitated by a stroke. Christine was looking for a mouthpiece for what amounted to a veiled regency that lasted until Cosimo II finally died. Okay, so in 1607, Caccini becomes not only a musical projection of Christine's quiet power, she becomes the leader over the next 10 years of a troupe, she calls it, or sometimes she calls it in her letters a school, of women, some professional musicians, some professional musician actors, I believe, but also ladies in waiting and the children, who performed musical theater entertainments for themselves and for Dad. There were a lot of performances that were organized for Cosimo II in his sick room at a kind of accelerated pace until he finally died in 1621. There aren't very many letters about these texts, nor are there very many surviving texts. But the letters that survive make clear that between Francesca Caccini and her favorite librettist, Michelangelo Buonarroti and Giovanni, who was still alive when Costa came to Florence, alive and well, who wrote specifically for Christine's sense of humor. In order to get the stressed out and overworked shadow region to laugh from her heart, that was the trick that Buonarroti and Caccini had mastered, was getting Christine to laugh from the heart. And they did that by his production of comedies mostly unidentifiable in his papers that were specifically, the parts were specifically chosen from Lotzi, from standard scenes and character types, to match the cast list which Caccini would send to him, not naming names, but naming specialties. Who was good at a pants part? Who was good at flamettes? Who was good at comedy? Of a ridiculous sort. So I think that the pleasure of these comedies that Ferdinand saw as a little boy, these comedies done fra di noi, the pleasure was in the interaction between the person that you knew and the persona that you saw the person perform. Because I think that these were not always a match from the letters that they were, that part of the joke was the mismatch. A person like me, you might think would play a pants part, but what if you made me the leading lady instead of this? Would only work in certain circumstances, right? But mostly it would be funny. It would be funny all the way through. So that's the comic culture. The comedies were always interspersed with music, some of it highly virtuosic, taught by Caccini to the children as well as to pupils who were in training to become ushimas at court. So there was a kind of intergenerational production of artistic labor that went on at Christine's court that to a certain extent it continued during the Regency in 1628, from 1621 to 1628, which was shared by Christine de Lorraine and Maria Magdalena. There are some contemporary reports that say that they were constantly at odds. I have to say the letters between them and the letters to the secretaries don't give that impression to me. But the impression nonetheless did circulate outside the court, and it may be that the workers were very, very circumspect in what they chose to preserve the archivia. There was a kind of shift during the Regency toward, away from comedy, and toward projections of female chastity as a kind of warrior stance almost. Different poets, different composers. Caccini was much less important, but my colleague Kelly Harness has written a book, the subtitle of which is Amazzone di Dio. That's how they were styling themselves, was the Amazzone di Dio. Saintly figures like Saint Ursula, protecting the city by protecting the boundaries of their own bodies from invaders. So that was kind of the cultural program. While Caccini and comic culture actually moved inside the convent where Ferdinand's destined wife, Vittoria della Rovere, with whom he really didn't get along, that is for sure, was being raised along with his younger sisters. And again, being taught by Caccini and others from the court in comedies that were sometimes a little raucous for convent life, but the Medici princesses, as they were called, could do what they wanted in La Crocetta. After doing what they wanted in the previous generation, caused so much trouble at Le Murate across the town. Ferdinand got rid of almost everybody in the first 12 years of his reign, who was part of the culture that his mother and his grandmother had cultivated. He made it uncomfortable for them. The thing he retained from his mother was an interest in projecting as a voice of power the castrato voice. The castrato voice was a legitimate projection of power, despite what we think in the 20th century or the 21st century about castrated men. That was not the issue. The issue was that a high voice was understood to be produced by a body able to exert extraordinary energy and exert this energy over others. So it was the voice of sovereignty. And for a time, it was the voice of sovereignty, regardless of whose body it came from. But Magdalena had this interesting possibly she had this notion, there's no way of knowing if it was conscious or not, to project her power through the castrato rather than through embodied women, which made it more logical for her son to do the same. Possibly. There's another thing that characterizes the patronage policy, as insofar as I know it, of Ferdinand early in his reign. My expertise stops in the mid-1640s, I'm sorry to say. And that is a return to a kind of diffusion of cultural life among his siblings. His brother, Cardinal Giancarlo, his brother Matthias, who was a general, his brother, Cardinal Leopoldo, all had their own courts with their own retinues of singers and actors and buffoons of various kinds. And each of them had their own tastes. So this like dispersal of power, I was thinking today, it was in fact a repudiation of both his mother and his grandmother, because the diffuse nature of the musical life at the Medici court is what had characterized Ferdinand I's reign. His brothers, Don Antonio and Don Giovanni, also had independent courts with singers on their payrolls, with entertainments that were produced solely from their household funds. And that was true of Giancarlo, who, though a cardinal, perhaps because he was a cardinal, was a well-known donaruolo, and was particularly fond, therefore, of women singers, including the Costa sisters, both of whom were in his circle, and both of whom profited from his connections in Rome, in France, in Venice, as I believe the translators may be able to say. Margherita Costa seems to me to have come at the end of a long tradition of valuing female performance, in which Ferdinand, of milieu, which Ferdinand was formed, but to have come actually just a little bit too late to have the kind of career that Francesca Caccini had, or that Adriana Basile had, who was a mouthpiece from time to time for the Dukes of Mantua and from time to time for the women in Florence, and other singers whom I could name, whose names most people have never heard. But Costa is kind of at the beginning of her career, she's at the end of something. A window of opportunity is closing. It's the year Caccini retired, and failing to find a place for her daughter at court, placed her daughter in a convent that was under the patronage of Vittoria della Rovere instead. Her daughter, who had been taught music alongside Vittoria della Rovere in the convent in the 1620s and 30s. So, with that, I turn it over to whoever goes next.
I'm going to sit right here so I can man the computer fort. Thank you, Suzanne, for those comments, which are so illuminating, I think, for Sarah and myself as well. Thank you all for coming. Thank you to Jane for the invitation to come. Thank you to CASA for housing us. Or hosting us. It's exciting to come present this book, which I'm holding today for the very first time, but is actually now out in print, and I will conveniently pass around information about how you may order a copy for yourself if you're so inclined. It's exciting to present this here because I think it was my last semester at NYU when Sarah and I think at an MLA reception, thought to ourselves, I wonder if women wrote any comedies. And so I guess we won't say how many years later, but some years later, here we sit underneath the comedy that we found and that we've had the pleasure and the challenge of translating. Sarah's gonna speak about the comedy itself and a bit of the work we did with that. But I wanted to start off by saying that we wanted to share this comedy, when we set out with our goals, we wanted to share this comedy with English audiences because it's such a ribald, fun time. But we also wanted to share the remarkable life of Margherita Costa with, I think, both an English and an Italian audience at some point, because she's been remarkably understudied for being the fascinating woman that she was. But her life is one that's riddled with question marks, and that was one of the things that we aimed to do with our audition in the introduction, was really clarify as much as we could facets about her life. So we started off with the things that we did know, which first was that she was born around 1600, 1610 maybe, in Rome. So that places her, she's going to be active in the kind of heights of the Baroque period, so she's definitively a Baroque writer and performer. She had an impressive singing career that we knew from the outset moved her between her native city of Rome to Florence in 1628, just as Ferdinando Secondo de Medici's cleaning house of, as Suzanne set out, of the women and men under the influence of his mother and grandfather, or grandmother, and this is Costa's coming in at this right moment. It's a little too late, but she's coming in at this perfect moment to be part of Ferdinando's new group. She also goes to Turin, Paris, and what looks most likely to be northern Germany. She's a sought-after opera singer, soprano, and when we set out, we knew that she had performed as Juno in Luigi Rossi's production of Orfeo that was written and staged in Paris in 1647, and that she had played, performed in at least one staging of Cavalli's The Giassone. We most importantly, for our purposes, knew that she had a really impressive publication record, 14 full volumes. I think we can all agree that is enviable. And that includes 6 volumes of poetry, which I show you here, as well as a mythological poem, Amorous Letters. Amorous Letters, the ones that Sarah will be translating for us. 4 theatrical works. The religious poem, a thick history of Ferdinando Secondo's coming to power, a collection of amorous letters, there we go, and 4 theatrical works, a mythological drama, The Buffoons, which we should point out is the first comedy published by a woman in Italy, a libretto for an equestrian ballet, and a libretto for a pastoral opera. In addition to that, she has great manuscript editions of 2 of these works. The one on the right is a manuscript edition of the poem about the religious poem about Saint Cecilia, and the one on the left is a marvelous and gorgeous edition of her equestrian ballet libretto that she dedicates to Ferdinando Secondo. Part of her strategy seems to have been her ability to really cultivate long-lasting and important relationships with really the choicest patrons to be found in Europe. So this is going to include, of course, Ferdinando Secondo de Medici, as well as his wife, Vittoria della Rovere, and other members of his family, like Cardinal Giovancarlo. Charles of Lorraine, Duke of Guise, who was then exiled in Florence, very conveniently for her. Cardinal Francesco Barberini, and through him, Pope Urban VIII. Marie Christine of France, who is the Duchess and, at this point, Regent of Savoy in Turin. Cardinal Jules Mazarin and Anne of Austria, Queen Mother and Regent of France, and collectively the Brunswick-Lüneburg Dukes of George Wilhelm, Ernst Augustus, and Johann Friedrich. Sorry, I'm not using my own computer, a little. But we've got, so it's a pretty respectable palette of patrons we had. And she's doing all this in a moment in which not only are the ground shifting for female performers, but this is a moment in which women's writing and women's publication is in a moment of sharp decline from a number of factors, but those include the uptick of misogynistic writing, kind of shifting cultures at the Italian courts, and the new sensuality of Baroque aesthetics, which for most women kind of shut the possibility of writing and publishing because of the kind of salty nature. Happily for us, Margherita Costa did not care about diminishing or tarnishing her reputation, and in fact, especially in her Florentine period, really embraces that sensuality. Working on Costa involved a lot of challenges, though, and we realized as we set out that a lot of the things we thought we knew about Costa turned out to be based on, for one, a brief description of her origins by a Roman satirist. So his satire is then replicated and given off as a kind of fact about her life. On rumors, including that she had married the buffoon to whom she dedicated the comedy The Buffoons, she didn't, or that all of her works were really written by a bandit in the Medici employ who was in jail for a good amount of years, but somehow, they said, had nonetheless published all her works, including those published in France. Who knows? We also had to sort through a lot of complaints about her reputation. Like many performing women, she was accused of being a courtesan. She may or may have not done. We do not know. I think we lean a little bit towards yes, but we think that that's ultimately not the most important thing about her. I think it's a lot more interesting that her near contemporaries described her, in the words of one, as most esteemed in Italy and abroad, and she shows up on lists of influential and important writers of the Seicento. But because she has this salty writing in a lot of her works, and because she may have had this origin as a courtesan, she's pretty quickly dismissed. And we can point to an example of Benedetto Croce, who's no friend of women writers at large, also hates the Baroque period. And for him, Costa fuses the two. And he kind of fretfully describes her works as scribbles and lambasts her as being ignorant and completely lacking in culture. But even her modern biographers have dismissed her as, one says, holding only historical value as a documentation of 17th century taste and a source of information about her contemporaries. We want to argue that she's certainly a lot more than an encyclopedia of other people of the Seicento. Even her most dedicated biographer in the 1920s, one Dante Bianchi, dedicates 100 pages to her, but he starts off by saying, I'm going to set aside all of her writing and really focus on figuring out if I can detect who her lovers were. And her writing, her literature itself is of less interest. And with that, we disagree as well. So things that we managed to set out as we kind of try to solve a lot of Costa's riddles. The first is that we've added Venice definitively to the places in which she was active. She's performing there in the 1650s on the Venetian opera stage and probably in the mid-1640s as well. These are three of the operas in Venice that we've connected to her to, of Cavalli, the Callisto, Eritrea, and the Rosinda. And she's using her Medici contacts to help her navigate the relationship she's forging in Venice at the time. We've also added a number of new works to her, which is somehow, in transporting this between my computer and this computer, has turned them to on their side. But the one, this is the 7 days, truly the trip to Loreto. It's a satirical conversion narrative, where the last two canti of seven describe her conversion, but the first two are things like her beating a cardinal who's trying to make love with her with a bedpan. To each their own, right? And we found later life poetry, so we've also extended the amount of time that we know that she's active. She seems to have been commissioned, for example, to write a broadsheet poem about Ye Big, about an event in the 1650s of great importance to the Barberini, a carousel, an operatic tournament that they held in the honor of Queen Christina of Sweden when she moved to Rome. So Costa has been asked by the Barberini, it seems, to write a poem about this event. We also try to add new context. So all of the places in which her biographers have said she's a failure, we've shown that there's actually a lot more going on. So for example, in her time in Turin, she arrives in 1645, and she's there for a few short months. And her biographers say, oh, well, she was a failure and she was sent away. In reality, what we've shown is that the regent of Turin at this time, Marie Christine of France, has just kind of survived victorious a multi-year siege in Turin, and in this moment is commissioning and programming a number of important operatic and equestrian spectacles for a number of months. So she seems to have been brought in for a very important performative function, rather than brought in, tried out, and sent away. But the most important contextualization we've done is that of her period in Florence. She's there for 15 years. It's here that she launches her publication career and where she prints 9 of her 14 works. This is not only her most fruitful period, but it's also her most versatile. So on one hand, she's writing dynastic works that are in support of the Medici, like the history of Ferdinando II's travels to Germany and his coming to power. Also, another example is her equestrian ballet, Libretto. But she's also writing a number of burlesque texts. And when you first look at a text of this nature, it has all the trappings of a woman who is trying to emulate her Cinquecento female peers, of giving the persona of an honest and virtuous woman. So she has the requisite portrait, she has poetry introducing her works by male celebrants, academicians, etc. And the first poems are always about the Medici, or the first letters are traditional lovers and beloveds. But the farther you flip through, the more you realize that she's doing something quite different. So her poetry, for example, is filled with very sexually experimental women. Her poems and letters move from these more traditional subjects to, for example, unexpected couplings, a witch and her bald lover, a deformed man and a crazy lady, a courtesan and her greedy client, and a hunchback and a cross-eyed woman. Her comedy, she calls My Burlesque Composition, as you might imagine, involves dwarves, hunchbacks, and buffoons pummeling each other and making dirty jokes. And I'm going to leave that round to Sarah, but I want to say that, that one of the things that we've discovered is that we really think that Florence offers her the opportunity, because of the tradition of comedic writing that is and comedic theater, it sounds, in this city, that she has a liberty to write in a certain manner and in a certain register in Florence that she no longer does once she leaves Florence. So her writing changes dramatically once she definitively leaves the city. And the buffoons, of course, is a great example of this burlesque comedic style. But unlike all of her other Florentine works, she's not dedicating this to Ferdinando or his brothers or anyone else of importance, at least of official importance. She's dedicating it instead to the Grand Duke's favorite buffoon, Bernardo Ricci. He shows up not only as the dedicatee, but one of the lead characters of the, and in fact, one of the eponymous buffoons. Ricci himself, Bernardo Ricci, was, like Costa, both a performer and an author. His text is called Il Tedeschino, ovvero Difesa dell'arte del cavaliere del piacere, Tedeschino, or Defense of the Art of Cavalier of Pleasure. And as you can kind of guess, he presents himself in this ennobling way as kind of exemplified by the 1637 etching by Stefano della Bella of Bernardo Ricci. In this dialogue, he draws together sources ranging from Plato to Castiglione to say that buffoonery is the oldest, the most important of the liberal arts. And in fact, those who call themselves philosophers are just failed buffoons. So it turns out that the buffoni is not, as some of Costa's earliest detractors say, a gift from wife to husband. She's definitively not married to Ricci. But it's what seems to be a satirical response to a tongue-in-cheek work about what it means to be a professional entertainer at court. But interestingly, and from this point I'll leave it to Sarah, is she's undermining Ricci's attempts at kind of self-aggrandizement and self-ennobling by making him the most absurd and detested character in her comedy. So she seems to be engaged in what would appear an ongoing conversation in mid-century Florence about comedic performance in a courtly context. And with that, I will leave it to Sarah.
Thank you, Jessica. Thank you, Jane and Suzanne. Those were wonderful introductions, and I think gave us a wonderful context to understand this very unique and exciting work that it was our pleasure to work together in translating, and we hope you'll like the result. So I'm going to speak a little bit about the nature of the commedia, of the generic form and the contents of the play, and some of the things that make it unique and notable, and hopefully encourage you to pick up a volume and read it yourselves. So as you can see, this is the title page for the Buffoni and the frontispiece executed by Stefano della Bella. Probably the play was printed in 1641, so this might have been executed in 1638 or 1639. This is a time when all Medici brothers, the princes, are working in concert to bring theatricals to the Grand Duchy. As Suzanne was mentioning, this is a work that they divided amongst themselves. They had independent, spectacular entertainments within their courts, but they also worked in concert. They worked together to really, as in the case of building of the theaters, they were both instrumental in building the Pergola, the Teatro della Pergola, and the Teatro del Cocomero, where classical tragedies and early forms of opera and comedies were staged. Comedies were also performed inside the Medici palaces, most likely in the Palazzo Pitti, in specially outfitted rooms with theatrical backdrops on hand for whatever visiting troupe of comic actors might come and visit. So what we see here in this frontispiece is very interesting. It is, we have an audience, a male and female audience divided in half. Different sense of perspective from the audience and from the scene that we're seeing represented above. The scene is a combination of the first, of the prologue and of the last act. The last act where Tedeschino and the prostitute get their just desserts and they're put in a cage and sent off. But we also have two figures from the prologue in the scene. So it's a kind of a conflation of the beginning and the end of the play. The setting is a Tuscan setting, even though the play is set in Morocco. This does not look like Morocco. I don't know what Morocco looked like in 1641, but I do know what Florence looks like now, and it looks much more like a Tuscan scenery with the requisite windows that you would need in order to stage a typically Renaissance comedy. So this might be a reference to the forced perspective that they would have in the Palazzo Pitti, the kind of scenery that they would expect to use for a production of this type. Or it could have been Stefano della Bella's imagining of what this scene should look like based on performances that he had seen. So one thing to note, as Suzanne was talking about, the Medici princes were, they had a long history of engaging with the arts and with theater. We know that their mother invited Maria Maddalena, invited troops of comedians into the Palazzo Pitti to perform for them while they watched behind screens sometimes, or sometimes they performed these scenes. So they had comedy in their blood. This was something that they enjoyed. There was what we would call more the official state form of spectacle, and then there was the comedy that they watched for their entertainment. And this is what the Buffoni, this is the tradition that Buffoni participates in. It is somewhat like a Commedia dell'arte. It is very much like a Commedia dell'arte, but it is most properly a Commedia ridicola or ridicolosa. Now, this is a particularly appropriate genre or subgenre of the Commedia dell'arte for Costa to be writing in, because as you can see in the title page here, we have Margherita Costa Romana. She's consistently identified as Roman in all of her title pages, and the Commedia Ridicola is a typically Roman subgenre of the Commedia dell'arte. It was performed at carnival celebrations, it was performed at marriages, other festive occasions. It was an ephemeral work of art, kind of thrown together in a matter of days, is what the authors would tell us. A form of light entertainment, not too ponderous, broadly appealing to all levels of society. It entertained popes and it entertained peasants. They were performed in the streets as well as in the private salons of Papal Rome. And it is a form that Costa may have brought with her to the Grand Duchy when she entered into the Medici court. So a couple words about the Commedia Ridicolosa. So it's a Roman genre. It bears a lot of generic similarities to the Commedia Erudita and the Commedia dell'arte. And even there's a lot of generic similarities. We have the same theatergrams, the same cross-dressing scenes, the recognition scenes. We have the unhappy wife and her laments, and we have all of those elements in the Commedia dell'arte, as well as in the Commedia Ridicolosa. The main difference, of course, being that this is a fully scripted comedy. This is a fully scripted comedy that has reads and feels like a Commedia dell'arte, which without any of the lofty pretensions of a Commedia erudita. These comedies were put together by dilettante playwrights. They were put together by doctors and lawyers, literate men who threw them together as a pastime and as a lark. They got their friends to act in them. They put them on during the carnival season, and then sometimes they were forgotten. Gian Lorenzo Bernini, he authored several of them, and we know that one of them is the Impresario. We know that he staged them in his home and built all the theatrical machinery that he would need in order to stage his Commedia Pericolosa. The actors in these plays were also non-professionals, and this is an important distinction. Even though we have a lot of the same lazzi, a lot of the same verbal and physical gags that you would see in a commedia dell'arte, this is a fully scripted play that can be pretty much interpreted by anyone. Better by you than by us, but by anyone. You don't need the trained professional comedian's knowledge of improvisational techniques. This is something that could be performed in the academies. This could be a form of diversion for any literate consumer of the Commedia Ridicolosa, which is another aspect of this subgenre of the Commedia dell'arte that is worth keeping in mind. These have a second life as literature and in print, as literature of mass consumption. For anybody, they were cheap. They were printed in duodecimos. They were sold along with almanacs on the streets of Rome. They traveled throughout Northern Europe and reached a very broad audience as a consequence. They were decorated with woodcuts. They were easily accessible and therefore could be used by the amateur actor or just somebody who chose to read a commedia, wanted to read a nice comedy. And these comedies were bawdy. They were titillating. They were a lot of fun to read, and they weren't too onerous for the reader. Oh, before I get to that. So there's one fundamental difference between, well, there are a lot of differences between Costa's Commedia Ridicola and the genre which it identifies itself with. Hers is not a cheap throwaway print. It is not. It is decorated with the frontispiece by Stefano della Bella, who is Florence's leading draftsman at this day. It's given a material existence that reflects the value that it had in the court. And we find it in the libraries of Galileo, we find it in the libraries of all the Medici princes. So this wasn't destined to be forgotten. This was given an import and a permanence, which speaks to Costa's role within the Medici court. And it's important for us to keep in mind as we study Costa moving forward and her other works, their value, their place, their prestige within the Medici court. So if we move forward to the court, and this ties into what Suzanne was saying earlier, what we have here is the dual presentation of who is in this play. Before this, a little background. What is the story? The story is that there's a prince and there's a princess. And the princess is the princess of Fessa, which is a city that its name not too subtly refers to the female vagina, so she comes from vagina land. Never thought I'd say that in the library of Gaza, but here we go. Then we have Meo, her husband, who's the prince of Morocco. They are in Morocco, and even though this is an exotic kingdom, there's no reference made to their actual location throughout the rest of the play. Marmota, the princess, is the reluctant heir to the kingdom of Fessa. There's the absence of the male heir, and she is slated to inherit this kingdom. The real problem, however, and there's a power dynamic issue here, is Mayo's refusal to perform his conjugal duties. It is stated in the argument of the play. It is acted out in the first scene of Act 1. Mayo refuses to sexually satisfy his wife, and she will not have it. She threatens to leave. The entire play is what follows. Her scenes are largely her deliberating whether she should stay or whether she should go. How can she be treated in such a way? So the sexual theme is explicit. And in this way, we can look at it kind of as a sex comedy. It's not only filled with sexual innuendos, but sex is the motivating factor behind this plot. One of the real meat of the play, however, are these characters. This is, we have two lists of characters. This is actually the list of characters, and these are the personages listed in Costa's letter to the reader as she begins her play. She tells that these are figures, these are people that she's going to represent au naturel. And we can imagine that these were unmasked characters. These weren't commedia dell'arte like figures or the masks, which sometimes appear in the commedia ridicolosa. We have commedia ridicolosa referring to Fritellino or to Colombina. Here we don't have that. What we have instead is a list of fools, hunchbacks, little people, people with linguistic masks, as in the Germans and the Spaniards and the Turks. It's a catalog of what one critic has called human deformity. On the other side, however, we have the cast of characters, and here's where we see a lot of these same figures in their more recognizable commedia dell'arte inspired roles. So we have Marmota and Meo, the prince and the princess. We could look at them kind of as the innamorati of this play. We have servants, we have maids, we have Tedeschino in the incongruous role of the innamorato, and we'll see that he fails miserably at that task. So this is one of the things that is of interest, and what Suzanne was saying before really situates Costa's novel cast of characters within a longer tradition of using figures from within the court within these plays. Because these, Teresa Megale's work and the Grand Ducal Archive of Florence has uncovered that these were real people. These were real dependents of the Medici in the court at the time. They were people, some of them were salaried buffoons, such as Baldassarre. Some of them had ambassadorial roles, such as Tedeschino, who was given a role of certain importance at the court. We have Croato and Catorca, we have Scatabocchio, we have these dwarves, these little people who, because of their physical deformity, were seen as, they were bound by ties of affection, but also they were entertaining. Their bodies were spectacular. They were asked to perform all sorts of manner, all sorts of tasks for the entertainment of the Medici. They were often made to fight among themselves. It was not the kindest form of entertainment we could imagine, but there were also genuine ties of affection that tied them to their Medici masters, essentially. And we move forward. Here we have a picture of Meo. Meo, this is a portrait by Justus Sustermans from 1640, painted at the same time of the Buffoni. This would be Meo, the Prince of Morocco. A buffoon known to have fits of violence. A buffoon who could be counted on to jump in the Arno if you asked him to do so, and would perform for tips. Other figures featured, if we look a little bit closer at Stefano della Bella's frontispiece, we see a couple visual pyramids, and we see at the center of this one right here, a little person. This is the focus of the play. This is the focus, what is the most interesting, according to Costa, and Stefano della Bella, interpreting the play later, the most notable aspect of this play. Here are the other two little people here. And of course, the roles that they're asked to perform are incongruous. They are chief huntsmen. They are, well, we have German mercenaries who speak in different forms of German dialects, but we have the buffoons who perform the roles of the innamoratos, and the incongruity, the things that are not fitting that make it most amusing, as we've seen before. So here, this of course participates in a tradition where such people were used for a spectacular form of entertainment, and more, they were risible, they were laughable, their mere form, the incongruity of seeing them engaged in a joust, in a gallant, militant role. It was that perceived absurdity was part of the entertainment value, and that's something that Costa definitely capitalizes in her work. Very quickly, another thing that Costa exploits for comic effect is sexual euphemism. And there are many of them, and they were a challenge to translate, very much so. because we don't necessarily have the same associations with fruits and vegetables, gourds, dairy products, garden hose, baskets, hats, and birds that Costa did. The language, the audience, the original audience, the intended audience of the Buffoni would have understood any number of the references to birds as being highly sexual, either the chase of birds, the chase of the beloved, the achievement of the beloved's favors, lures used to obtain the beloved. All of these were expressed using references to owls, pigeons, doves, wagtails, all kind of, we know so much about birds now. I never thought I would know so much about birds. But in any case, and they were sexy, and Costa has a lot of birds. There were also references that were hard to unpack, references to sexualize architecture, references to sexualize garments. If it could be sexualized, Costa did. She did so. And I'll leave it to you to decide if we adequately rendered her highly charged language into English. Sometimes we just had to footnote things. Sometimes there was no equivalent for a sexy lettuce patch. But hopefully when you read the play, you'll know, you know, you're winkingly on a lettuce patch, and you'll know how to read it appropriately. Now that I have filled your heads with dirty thoughts, I would like to turn our attention to our two performers. We're very lucky to have them here tonight. They're going to be performing a scene from Act 1, Scene 12. This is Balassare, his first appearance on the scene. One very important thing that I have to mention that was a challenge for us as translators, and it's important to understanding the commedia ridicolosa genre to which the Buffoni is indebted, is the plural lingualism. It was an aspect, of course, for anybody who's familiar with the Commedia dell'arte, you know that there's going to be the Bolognese doctor, there's going to be the Venetian pantalone, the Tuscan lovers. In the Commedia ridicolose, the multiplicity of language reaches hyperbolic heights that piled on top of each other to increase comic effect. And we see this in Costa's play. We have not only one German, but we have two Germans, each one with their own distinctive linguistic tics, which we try to render differently, adding some kind of order, following Costa's clearly discernible accent within. We also have the Spanish braggart, who speaks more Spanish than Italian. We reached a compromise on how we approached Baldassare, and we're going to see how that works now in the performance. We have a Turk, we have a number of different languages, accents, and dialogues, and instead of smoothing out these different linguistic styles and tics in our translation, as is sometimes done with a little note saying this character speaks in Spanish or heavily Spanishized Italian, we put it in there. So we're going to see if it works. Baldassare enters the scene. This is his first entrance into the scene, and he meets with Tedeschino, who has been trying unsuccessfully to woo Marmota for some time.
And these are both buffoons.
These are both
warring buffoons who were actually competitors in real life as well.
Thank you.
Don Baldassare, bravura del mundo. My principal merit is that I am Espanol. I am known in all the provincias, caballero del placer, escambarada of princes, amigo and counselor of kings, purveyor of their gustos and of their services for their recreacion and for my own fun. And I am an indispensable part of La Corte, medico, astrologo, herbalist, druggist, apothecary, necromantico, filósofo, teólogo, buffoon, right-hand hombre for kingly conversaciones, and virtuoso of the sciences, royal mapumandi of every doctrina, poet, musician, and improvisador, witty trickster, and doctor.
Oh, Mariska Swindler! Ooh. Good day to the doctor, bravura. Mm. Ooh, what are you up to all by your lonesomeness?
Your Excellency is most welcome to here.
Oh, thank you.
What is your business with my affairs?
Oh, well, now that you are, that your amcroya is the handkerchief for Prince Mio's nose, the little box for his musk,
oh,
the trap for his mouse, and for his water, the vase.
Oh.
No one can yank your chain round the place.
May los diabolos be drag you away, you liar!
No.
I have nada to do with her.
What?
This man here does not sing her praises.
No, I love her.
I am no Tedeschio who traffics with todos and horns.
Ooh.
Detestable picaroon!
Oh.
By all 24 letters of the alphabeto, you are reviled.
Oh,
listen up.
Okay.
A, ass,
yeah.
Bonehead,
mm-hmm.
Coward,
yeah.
Delinquent,
ooh.
Erring heretic,
oh.
Fanfaron, and todo that the letter implies.
He means the F word.
Garbler, lobo, mooch, mierde.
Excuse me.
Muncher, not a parent.
Oh, what do you mean? 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 What do you mean?
If you want to compare yourself to me,
uh-huh.
Picado, coward, scoundrel, you have some sharp kicks coming to ya. I'll turn you to dust with one letter more. You, born in Italia, you have insulted the name of your homeland by calling yourself Tedeschio. Oh, civil comunidad. Scourge of the land, infamy of El Mundo, braggart in times of peace,
well,
and sloth in times of war.
Well, careful now, swindler of the court, vaunter of urine, undertaker of the ill, disgrace to the art of medicine.
Me? Are you talking to me?
Oh.
Puerco, disgrace, loco!
Oh.
Me, with so much bravura, dispenses my medicina. You call me a two-bit clown? The vaunter of urine? Whoever takes my powders soon enough becomes powder, too. Whoever ingests my brew...
Oh, thank you.
No longer counts among the living. And so, my medicina kills off the old and sucks the young.
You've never said so much and spoken so soundly, Baldassare. Do it my way. Flee the sick and play with the sound.
Oh, quiet, you scoundrel, you ass. Listen to what Baldassare tells you. Throughout El Mundo, I am a medical virtue of reputation, mucho más esteemed than you. And for my merits, the Count of Conde has already given me a chain of gold.
What?
From the Queen Madre, I received a chain worth 100 doblas.
Ooh.
From the King, a vestment worth 2,000 ducados. From the Duca de Navarra, a chain. The Duca de Buckingham, a neck chain. Spinola?
A chain.
Mantua?
A chain.
Yasuna?
A chain.
Donkes?
A chain.
A horse from his son.
Oh, nice!
Filiberto?
A chain!
The king, a neck chain. And from the queen of España,
another chain? Oh, and yet no one figured out how to chain you up with a rope long enough for you to hang.
Be quiet, you coward! I'm going to give you 100 licks of my cane if you don't shut up. Don't know what to do with that.
Oh, faithless!
Well, famous breeder.
Breed of riffraff, Morisco, low life, vaunter of nothing. Friday and Saturday eater of entrails, pardon me, heretic, drunkard, smartass, who'll hold me back so I don't wring your neck? Come on, who's at it? And put you to the end of your great conceit, you enemy of salted meat, doctor without a doctorate, physician without science, buffoon without diplomacy, windbag without material, Jewish mule with all that's on your codicil.
Oh, you picaro coward, picaroon, face of the executioner and the dead, I am ashamed to speak with you.
Oh, you Spanish heretic, you call me a dead man?
Whoever speaks with you, you dirty little picaro, comes away much disgraced. I want to kill myself when I'm with you.
Whatever you want, go ahead. On guard! Woo! I'm not going there. I'm going to hack you to pieces right now. On with your sword, you slouch. Do you surrender, Marino?
Oh, enough, enough. Did the skia put your sword back in its sheath? It weighs on me to kill the greatest political ass in El Mundo.
Put your hand on your sword, big shot. What, are you scared? I'm not afraid of loudmouths. Hand on your sword. Go on. I don't want to kill you by unfair advantage. What? You slouch? You don't want to draw your sword? What? Do you surrender? Oh, victory! Victory! I'd like my statue to be erected in this spot and your spoils hung by the side in memory. Yes, victory! Victory!
I'm sure there must be questions for the actors, for the marvelous translators and editors, and for Suzanne, so please feel free. And I have one to start with for Jessica and Sarah, which is about collaboration. We just saw a terrific collaboration happening here with Richard and Ali. And obviously your collaboration has been ongoing. We haven't been able to see it in action except for this amazing product of this translation, which seems to be a wonderful way of infusing the Spanish of Baldassare with the English of the translation. So it seems like that was just a really effective kind of move. So how did this collaboration work? I mean, how did it, you know, logistically you were very far away from each other.
Google Docs,
okay. The answer is Google Docs.
Well, I think we were aided by the fact that we were not working on a treatise or a poetry. We were working on a comedy, a theatrical work, and so we started by dividing up the characters. And we kind of volleyed it back and forth. So we created our Google Docs, which was very effective. But we would write back and forth to each other in the various voices. And then when we got to the end, we started at the beginning and we reversed them. So that we could make sure that everything, you know, it's a way of double checking, but it kept it fresh.
And it was very effective because as we started, we wanted to give each character its unique voice. But then we wanted some consistency within the play itself. So we both had our hand in each character. One of us formed each character at the beginning, and then we dipped back in and we gave it some uniformity. So there's a consistency of the pain in the play, but there's some uniqueness. And it made for a lot of interesting Sunday afternoons where we would get on the phone and we'd read these characters out loud to see if it sounded right. Mm-hmm. I always sounded like Mae West when I was the prostitute. We each had our own voices in our heads that we were then expressing onto the page. And having each other check our work, we actually got to see, is that voice coming through, is it not? Are we overinterpreting, are we not? It was very effective.
There were kind of two main phases. The first was the ground floor foundation translating process, and that was all via Google Docs. But it's true that when we got to the next stage, we wanted to make sure it sounded that it could, in theory, that it could be performed. We didn't know if we would ever see it, and you guys have given us a great gift. We didn't know if we would ever get to see it, but we wanted it to at least read like it could be performed. So we did, at that point, I was in Florence, and Sarah was in Connecticut, so we would meet on Google, or maybe just, we were Skyping at that point.
We were Skyping
and reading it to each other. So we were, I don't know what voices we did, some very bad German impressions.
Yes.
And there was a lot of Googling of how to do a German pronunciation.
It sounded like Colonel Klink at times.
But so there was a writing phase and there was an oral phase. Mm-hmm.
obviously. Made all those many years and months of working together pay off. Really terrific.
When can we get this?
Now.
Now.
We can. Yes.
I have a question for both of you.
Yes.
So this is a great text, I mean, and I have to say that I already, I mean, I'm going to buy the book because I'm going to use it, you know, next semester in one of my classes. So do you have any suggestions? And, you know, it's a very complex text, you know, to use. How to teach this text, how to convey this to other undergraduate or graduate, you know, students.
Have you gotten to teach with it yet? I know you've done
a class. No, I'm teaching a comedy class right now, and I've used parts of it, the introduction. The introduction was very useful because it gives a general context for comedy and women's writing at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So she is a lesser known figure right now.
Right.
A lot of the information may not be so useful for the undergraduate classroom, but
mm-hmm.
incorporating all the work that has been done on female playwrights, pairing it with a text like Andreini,
mm-hmm.
where sexuality is, well, you have to think about the physical representation of it, you have to think about the satyr scene, and where's the comic element, where's that shining through, versus this text where it is on the page, it is quite, you have to have the historical context in order to understand it, but it's not something that is as implied necessarily,
mm-hmm.
though there were elements that your performance brought out that I couldn't have even imagined.
That flicking of the tongue, we didn't
yes,
do that part.
No, we never did that on Skype.
That wasn't
yeah.
on the screen. I thought it was nice. No, tongue in and out.
I think it is a comedy that begs to be at least in part acted out,
right.
because it is
mm-hmm.
such a
That's,
physical
yeah,
comedy,
exactly.
and there's only so much that, as Sarah was saying, there was only so much we could do in terms of footnotes,
mm-hmm.
And we made a, well, when we were looking at stage directions, because ours is a facing pages translation,
mm-hmm.
we thought, well, we're going to keep only the original stage directions in the Italian side, and we're going to supply what we I think are the minimal stage directions we need to add to that for it to be understandable. But the original footnote or the original stage directions are primarily about musical performance.
Mm-hmm.
So that, you know, here starts a song, the princess is going to sing for this bit, etc. Some of the more, there are scenes where we have all of the characters who speak with a heavy accent all on stage at the same time. She tends to end her acts like that, and they are pummeling each other. And so it's a flurry of fists and a flurry of tongues. And there I think we had to add some in, but those are, I don't know if you want to have your students beat each other. I do think that some enacting,
right.
I think I would, if and when I get to take it into my classroom.
And I definitely think that since there are these modular scenes, since there are these theatergrams, you can read it against Scala, you can read it against another Commedia dell'arte text,
mm-hmm.
and show how they appear. Here we have it, it's fully scripted on the page, play. You don't have to you know the character dynamics going into it.
Mm-hmm.
You know that you're going to have the two buffoons, that one's going to be
mm-hmm.
Arlecchino, like one's going to be the Spanish bragger. What does that actually look like when you interpret that into
mm-hmm.
these fully scripted texts?
Mm-hmm.
So a little study beforehand of the character dynamics, of scenes with two, with three, the increasing of action and activity, with the inevitable meeting of everybody on stage and all their different accents, it would make for a fun staging in class.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. How was it for you guys as actors? Had a little bit of experience, or what was your collision with the text?
I found it a lot easier to read than a lot of other comedian plays that I've ever read.
Yeah.
Like it translates really well.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
Like if you read, there's some. I'm working on this play at Juilliard right now called The Green Bird by Carlo Gozzi.
Mm-hmm.
And the two translations we used for that are both very different.
Mm.
And we kind of putting them together was a little, the story gets lost a little bit. But this one just, yeah, I don't know, seems very, very clear somehow. Yeah, I don't know. It seemed pretty right there what needed to happen.
And I have to say that I was really really eager to see how this scene played out with all the Spanish in there. Because one thing that we decided was, as I said before, was not to smooth out the Spanish, not to make both characters speaking in English with a little note saying one of them is going to speak with a Spanish accent, because that's not true to the original text. We're assuming that an audience reading or seeing the original text may not have known all of the Spanish that was in the text. There has to be some level of inference, there's some level of reading for the original audience and also our current audience. When we chose the Spanish nouns, we didn't use verbs, we used nouns to keep it to the text. We used cognates or words that somebody who, with even a passing familiarity of Spanish, would be familiar. They would be able to figure out from the context of the play itself. Or at least you're going to know that this is an insult. You're going to know from the rest of the context that this is going to be an insult. So that was wonderful to see how that was delivered.
And I think as an actor, you want, especially in comedic play, the funnier sounds that you can say on stage is the best. I mean, getting a language in them, text in another language to say it is fantastic. It's so much fun for your mouth to play with. Mm-hmm. So I thank you for keeping that.
I should jump in and say this is actually not the first 21st century staging of Cosa. We discovered that there was a staging. It was the first North American, you did the North American debut.
That's all I promise.
Yes. But we discovered that in March in Bologna, I believe, they did a staging of the buffoons.
I saw it on that because I was looking on YouTube. I mean, maybe they have some clips.
Yeah, they have a kind of like summary clip if you're interested.
I haven't had the chance to watch it yet, but I was just interested, now to see this. I mean, and to talk with the editors, the translators. I mean, it's a treat,
So. And one of the things that is interesting that they did with it, I mean, there's a lot of different kind of plays happening in this play, and so that kind of ties into your question of how you would teach it, right? There's a play that's all about marital relationships and gender jokes and sexuality. There's a play that's all about internationality, etc. And that was the portion of it that this director decided to focus on. So it's not, he kind of stripped out a bit the love, the sex story of it, and he focused on the internationality of the various players and made it a kind of a discussion about immigration in Italy at the moment. Which I think is a fast. So the fact that they have all these international characters, they emphasized even more than we did.
Are the characters who end up in cages international?
No, there's Tedeschino in the process.
Because the fact that they end up in cages is also kind
but
of
they are shipped
you
off.
Do interesting things in a classroom.
Yeah.
They,
I don't know if you want to encage your students.
You have to find a human-sized cage. They're shipped off to Fessa at the end because they disrupt, they threaten the husband and wife, and they threaten the legitimate line of power, which ultimately is handed back to Mayo when the long-lost brother is discovered, the logic of which really kind of...
Well, and funnily enough, the long-lost brother is the Spanish buffoon.
Right.
So he's
right.
The key to the resolution
right.
of the whole play, is that he's actually the proper prince of...
He gave
it away. It's in the introduction.
That is true.
Yeah, all these looks... great and sounds great. I have a question about singing within the play because you mentioned that there's also that role. I mean, I only had sort of been going through this comedy in Italian years ago, and I can't remember whether the comedy sort of includes sung pieces, and if so, how did you deal with those particular passages in the text in your translation, thinking about the ideal outcome, which would be a performance.
Well, we have there's a song that is intended to be there's songs between the acts. There's a song at the conclusion, kind of sums everything up, and we mark those off in the text in italics, so you know that this is something that is intended to be delivered differently. We tried to conclude the songs. We had more rhyming with the songs to give them more of a musical quality to them. There's also recitative parts within the text with Marmota singing. And you can imagine maybe this is a role that Costa would have interpreted herself because she was primarily a singer. She has a lot of lines, too. So you can see that she wrote herself a juicy role. So singing does have quite a big role in this play. And we tried to differentiate that on the page. And there is one of Costa's musical pieces that she composed is available. Well, it's just the text. Does it have the accompanying music? It's in the Grove.
Yeah. There are.
One of her musical.
At least
pieces.
One of her poems, but not connected to the flutes, has been set to music.
No.
You could go on YouTube and listen to that as well.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But it is interesting that her comedy does include the texts of the three introductory and then the three intermezzi. So and in addition to the musical quality, if one wants to also have students perform, there's a whole other high level of dance that
mm-hmm.
she's imagining. And so the kind of performative elements, aside from the actual obvious theatrical ones, are the presence of music. She lists a number of dances that are supposed to be kind of integrated in, and the final scene around those two Cage characters, they're performing a dance, a kind of taunting dance around them.
Mm-hmm.
But there are also acrobatic scenes. Tedeschino, the Bernardino Ricci character, pretends to do equestrian ballet on a hobby horse, like on a wooden stick. He's dancing around and pretending like it's a horse. I mean, so she and those are the bits that she includes in her stage direction. So those are clearly things that she's highly invested in.
And that's another interesting thing about this play. It would have required a skilled performer or Nagel to be able to perform these parts. You would have needed singers. You would have needed somebody capable of doing the acrobatics that she requires, because it requires specifically a certain number of somersaults, for example. This is not something that an amateur could have done, even though that's typically who would have been consuming these kinds of comedies. It required the talents of characters that were already in the employ of the Medici and already performing these kinds of duties for the Medici, though not necessarily grouped together in a commedia d'arte troupe and performing regularly in prescribed roles, but capitalizing on their talents.
But so I have a question about
Giovanni,
yeah,
go ahead.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, okay, thank you. No, I was just curious for the translators, because besides the ornithological enigmata and the multiplicity of registers, I imagine, you know, an ulterior challenge for translators with texts like this is to convey humor.
Yes.
Because, you know, maybe something that might sound funny in Italian
right.
to an Italian might not
for
sound funny.
For 17th century Italian.
Exactly,
right.
to 17th century Italian. Or something else that was humorous but politically incorrect, maybe
mm-hmm.
in days, I can imagine, you know, there might be a lot of material under this point of view,
mm-hmm.
like, you know, in the text. So, long story short, the questions are, how hard was it to convey the sense of humor? And did you face any particular challenge under that point of view, something that was like, okay, how do we convey this in English?
It was very challenging.
How do we keep the humor?
It was very challenging, and that's why reading it out loud together really helped. And
yeah.
so what we tried to avoid at all costs, though we often have to do this, was footnote it. Why this would be funny, why this was
mm-hmm.
a sexual allusion
mm-hmm.
that would have been amusing.
Yeah, exactly.
How to translate corna.
Yeah,
right? That's
exactly,
very
yeah.
difficult. That's very culturally
and
specific.
And there's a lot of corna puns.
Right.
Kind of cuckold.
There's
I
a cornicione.
Exactly
there's
that.
A, like,
yes.
is it a little pickle? Because then it's also a heraldry. It's also, it means all these different things. It's a discussion. Is it, there was no one word in English that captured all the multiple meanings for corna, for
yeah,
example.
Yeah, happen all the time. Like,
yes,
this
all the time.
Really
I mean,
challenging.
We were able to find analogs. We also wanted to find words that there was no true equivalency, of course,
mm-hmm.
in any translation. There's going to be challenges there. We tried also not to be anachronistic, so we didn't
mm-hmm.
want to use English language terms that might have given it a saucy feel, might have given it that body kind of character, that comic element that we might have liked, but it would not have been true. It might have been coming from a mechanical realm that was not true to the time. So we really had to be very careful with our translations. Sometimes we had to sacrifice the comic element in order for clarity and
mm-hmm.
to stay true to the text.
But I think there was a certain point where we kind of we created our foundation where we were comfortable that we were as faithful as we could be to the text. And then we kind of let go a
yeah.
little bit. And we decided, you know, there were certain moments where we sacrificed the
mm-hmm.
humor, but I think there were certain moments too where we kind of
yeah.
dove in,
right.
and there, you know, we had numerous conversations about, you know, is this too dirty,
right?
Right.
yeah, exactly.
Usually we
yes.
decided no,
right? Not dirty.
Because
Jane gave us the note that it was perhaps not dirty enough at some point.
Yeah,
we shouldn't forget that. Yeah. Okay.
I think that
Thanks for sharing.
You know, and to get to that kind of Benedetto Croce complaint about her work as scribbles, I think that it was the moments when we were working on these kind of deeply, what we discovered to be deeply compact, kind of onion style jokes that she was making. So she has all of her themes, her kind of euphemistic, oh boy, like the birds, the nets, the food, and all of a sudden you realize that you're flipping through your, we found these, you know, great dirty dictionaries, and realize that some of her word choice are feeding into three different fields of euphemism that she's using. So she's just finding the perfect terms. And then we had to make some choices. Yeah, but we appreciated her as a writer more and more the deeper we got into the comedy, and realized that it was not scribbles, that these were very well chosen.
And one last thing I have to say about that is that the one thing that I think we did sacrifice was the syntax, which, looking at what was intentionally difficult syntax, we had to kind of smooth out for the sake of readability, so it could be performed, so it could be read easily. Mm-hmm. That was one of something that's very distinctive in her style, very Baroque in her, and would have contributed to the comedy originally, to the comic pleasure of reading a difficult text that it was. But that's one of the things that, as we returned to the text and we gave ourselves a little bit more license, we kind of made it a little bit more readable.
What's amazing, besides translating across the century, you're also translating from country to country and with modern means of communication, the computer,
mm-hmm.
telephone,
mm-hmm.
which makes it quite an achievement.
Thank you. Yes.
Mm.
Suzanne, I kind of did because the heterosexuality of both Ferdinand and his wife,
mm-hmm.
Were dubious.
Mm-hmm.
And so I want to know whether the sexuality jokes,
mm-hmm.
included any what we would call homosexual jokes, same sex sodomy jokes.
I didn't get any homoeroticism. There was the question about, you know, the whole issue is that he will not perform his conjugal duties, right? And
which was the issue with them,
but that kind of postdates that because they had given a child, one died. Given birth around this time,
yeah.
So this is still the time when they are at least having relations, and they are creating, bearing children. This isn't the period of estrangement. Though some critics did look to see that. They tried to see the marital discord as a sign, as a reference or an allusion to Ferdinando and Vittoria's fraught relationship.
But so all of the sexiness is heterosexiness. And so they're refraining from participating in, or she's refraining from participating in the gossip about Ferdinand that predates his marriage.
Yes, absolutely. It reinforces his virility. I mean, this is a lusty man who, the only reason why he's not with his wife is because he's out philandering with whores and with dwarves, and he's out drinking. This is not a man who is distracted by other attractions. He's very much into the women. So it is an assertion of his heterosexuality.
Okay.
He's quite emphatic now. And the conclusion of the play, in fact, it is a reassertion of his patriarchy.
Well, let us thank our wonderful performers, Professor Kuzik for her fabulous introduction, and our wonderful translators, editors, critics, and we will look forward to the next several batches of work on Magari Tagosa as it progressively comes out, both digitally and in paper.